just want to start from there and say that for case one, this is a patient who had been on peritoneal dialysis for 10 years. And in peritoneal dialysis, the catheter is permanent. So there was no way we wanted to lose this catheter because the patient needed to continue with the dialysis. So as you can see, this is where the rupture was. And what happened is that the patient had the just a small incision with the surgeon at the bedside, and the external dacron cuff was removed. You can see the dacron cuff, and this was to just lengthen the catheter.
And then the catheter was cut aseptically, of course, after soaking in betadine for around 5 minutes. And you can see now the catheter has been rerouted to another exit site. And because now it has become shorter, the dacron cuff was actually shaved and left outside. And the titanium adapter was disinfected and connected to a new transfer set. So this catheter rupture was saved. The catheter was saved. The patient did not have interrupted peritoneal dialysis and did not have to be switched to HD, because this patient never wanted to go back to ever go to HD, and yet the patient required to continue with dialysis. So this patient was started on 2 liter cycles immediately because the rectal, it was just the subcutaneous tissue that was incised, and there the exit site was reluted. The peritoneum was never touched. The rectus sheath was never touched. So I for the other patients, because the catheter was not so close to the exit site, I wanted to show you how it was, which I had already shown you, but since I lost you, I want to show you now. You can see it was just next to the titanium adapter. And what you do is to make sure that you clamp the catheter, the side of the catheter that is proximal. So that to the proximal to the rupture, so that you don't allow entry of microorganisms, because that contamination can lead to body tunnel and also internal peritonitis. And I want to exit there. So I can say that for the other three patients, the repair was done by cutting the ruptured segment and disinfecting the area, disinfecting the titanium adapter, refixing the titanium adapter again under pure aseptic technique, and reconnecting again the transfer sets. So as far as the discussion to this small study is concerned, I can say that the above cases demonstrated the successful management of a spontaneous rupture of PD catheter with no peritonitis, all tunnel infections. Thereafter, these patients were safe. They never developed any complications. They continued with the dialysis, and the catheters were spared and saved. And the women were more affected than men. The cause of the rupture was not established, but in case one, it looked like it is prolonged use of povidone iodine. Prolonged use of povidone iodine and also mupirocin touching the catheter can cause kind of erosion and end up actually with the rupture. And you find that the ruptured area had stains with the povidone iodine. So it was thought of that the cause of the rupture was continuous corrosion and erosion from the povidone iodine at the exit site. And also the research has shown that mupirocin, if you kind of keep on putting mupirocin on the catheter itself, it can cause erosion and rupture, eventual rupture of the catheter. The other two cases were more like mechanical It's like the patient is strained, and the cause of the breakage in those three relay was not evident, but it was thought of it being maybe more of mechanical. So most of the published instances are external breaks that are associated with the mechanical and chemical stress, which I think was the cause in this particular patient. In conclusion, partial peritoneal dialysis catheter replantation is simple, safe, and effective salvage procedure for patients with the catheter injury. Repair of damaged catheter extends the life of the catheter, allowing the patient to continue with the peritoneal dialysis. And I want to tell you that I managed a patient who had used a single catheter for 18 years on peritoneal dialysis. What are the important changes that we need to emphasize in our units? Patient education. Because if the patient doesn't report to hospital on time and probably ignores, this is a patient who may end up losing their peritoneum and they may not be able to continue if they have peritonitis and they have adhesions and all those complications. It's important to advise the patients not to keep the catheter in an acutely bent position. So when we are doing the exit site care, we teach the patient to put the catheter in a sealed position. And I believe that as we continue maybe mobilizing and advocating for peritoneal dialysis, I'll be able to teach the nurses how to maintain the catheter in a sealed position. PD staff education is very, very important as far as PD catheter rupture is concerned. Remember that it is the PD nurse that the patient will find on duty. And I must say that where I was working in that hospital, there is a 24-hour coverage of the peritoneal dialysis unit. So the staff are there and they are ready to manage the patients. Take-home message, it's very important to start the patient on immediate antibiotic cover because you want to prevent peritonitis and tunnel infection. The other important thing is that you want to immediately clamp the area proximal to the break so that you don't allow, you prevent entry of microorganisms. Immediate repair, stroke post repair, 10 days antibiotic cover is very, very important. And catheter removal and replacement is not necessary. You can repair the catheter and move on and on. I still want to acknowledge ISPD, ISN for funding my fellowship. I appreciate Professor George Abraham for mentorship and Dr. Twahil and all my friends from India who helped me learn a lot. Thank you very much. Those are some of the references. You can read a lot on catheter spontaneous peritoneal dialysis catheter rupture. Thank you so much for listening. Over to you, Madam Nyarena.
Thank you so very much, Grace. I think I am very happy. And more importantly, that this subject of peritoneal dialysis as a modality of treatment for patients with either acute kidney injury or end-stage renal disease, we are almost like not doing quite well in Kenya. I'm so happy, Grace, that the zeal you have, we are actually going to go back in full swing and be able to start patients on peritoneal dialysis. It's also important, the fact that we really don't need to pull out catheters or to change patients to HD anytime they have a problem. We have answers ready from the presentation that these patients can actually be salvaged. You don't need to get another catheter. And if it's a must, you better even put in another catheter instead of switching the patient to HD. So thank you very much. I think we take a few questions. In the question and answer box, Grace, there is one member of the meeting who requested to know which type of dialysis could be recommended. I don't know in which aspect, but that was a question. And then there was also another request from Bernard Mwega, who also wanted to know who was asking, are PD catheters made of the same material as long-term HD catheters? That was the question from Mwega. Mwega also had asked about can povidone iodine have a negative effect on long-term HD catheters, the same way we have seen on PD catheters. And the first question that was asked was from Angela Sambele, who was asking what type of dialysis is best recommended. Would you want to react, Grace, to those questions?
Yes, thank you very much, Madam Nyarela. I hope everybody can hear me. According to research, it is recommended that patients can start on peritoneal dialysis because, number one, there is better transplant outcome for patients who are on peritoneal dialysis than hemodialysis, and that is the exit replacement therapy, kidney replacement therapy that you all recommend. And this is basically because you are preserving the vascular access. You are not risking the patient to thrombosis and stenosis because you need those vessels for the transplanted kidney. And the other thing is that the patients, as you can see from the research I did earlier, the hemoglobin levels are much, much better maintained for patients on peritoneal dialysis. And so you are avoiding things like transfusion, which also can trigger the immune system and even lead to rejection eventually. So you want, first of all, to preserve the vessels, the vascular access. You want to prepare the patient for transplant. And also you want to maintain the residual kidney function. So if possible, you'll want to start the patients on peritoneal dialysis and prepare them for transplant and maybe preserve the vessels maybe in future, should you want even to put, like, for example, a fistula. So that is the way I would answer. And I would say that there is a lot of research that has been done. And that is why we have some countries like Hong Kong, Mexico, that have actually started the PD first policy. In terms of patients starting on dialysis, it is PD first. We have Hong Kong, we have Mexico, we have places like now, Canada and US. So I have a list of all those places where they have gone for the PD first policy. So, and also in terms of the permanent catheter for hemodialysis, I'm not sure whether the materials are the same, but I know that this PD catheter is more of silicone. It's a soft catheter that is friendly to the tissues, and it's not a rigid, it's not, it just becomes part of the body. And I would say, I think, the permanent catheter for hemodialysis, I think, is the same. The only difference is that for peritoneal dialysis, the catheter is not in a blood vessel. So there are no risks of stenosis, no risks of thrombosis. This is a catheter that is safe. So you don't really worry about it blocking unless there are other complications like rupture or maybe fibrins, which is rare. So I would say that povidone iodine is also not really recommended as it erodes the catheter. And I think that's why in most cases, it's good to use normosaline for the exit site, or maybe inhibiting in water, because povidone iodine, even for the dressings and even for wound management, it really interferes with granulation of the tissues. But I think we can read more, we can come up with more researches and see whether there is any problem in using povidone iodine for catheter exit site, but I think in most countries, they are not using povidone iodine for the catheter exit site because of the irritation of the catheter, the skin, and all that. And actually, where I worked in India, we never used to use povidone iodine. Actually, we used Hibitin in water for the exit site. Thank you so much.
So what is important is about the antibiotic cover, then the clamping of the proximal. Then we have immediate repair. Then we have catheter removal and replacement, not always necessary. So she said you can still salvage that catheter as long as you're working within the 10 days. Is that what you meant, Grace?
Yeah, the repair should be immediate and there should be post-repair 10 days antibiotic cover and then follow-up.
Yeah.